I get situated, if you don't mind. I'm going to do a little housekeeping here. Whoever that is, it won't go anywhere, I promise. Well, I must say, I do get to speak to different places and to different events, but when Rick sent me a text over Christmas, at some point at Christmas, I think, actually, we were down in Orlando at the Under Armour game or somewhere. We've been a little bit everywhere in the last several months. I don't even know where I've been half the time. But when Rick texted me, it was a great honor to be asked to come and speak. I'm very passionate in life, very passionate, very blessed, very thankful. And to have the opportunity to come speak here, where I consider one of the places that I've cut my teeth as a Christian, as a dad, and as a man, with Pastor Danny and so many very, very close, dear friends. To me, to my family, it's an honor to be here and to speak to this group and this group of men. So many, I was telling Steve Hancock and I were in here at the beginning, and I remember, I guess it was about 10 years ago, that we had a Sunday school class right back there that I was in, my wife and I. And so just neat to have seen. I see so many faces out here that were in that Sunday school class, and we've shared a lot of growing up together with kids and watching them go off and go here and go there, and watching Greg get his heart broken by his son going to Auburn. Where you at, Greg? But it's okay. See, Greg's still alive, aren't you, Greg? It's okay. Not sure how he has survived that, but it's okay. But it is an honor to be here. Really is. And I must be honest, I'm a little shocked that I am here. This week was a very eventful week for me. I guess it was maybe Tuesday, one of our coaches walks into my office around lunch. He said, "Coach, you got any crazy texts or phone calls or anything today?" I was like, "No, Pete, nothing out of the ordinary. Should I have?" And he said, "Well, I got this tweet earlier that sent me to your Wikipedia link. And according to Wikipedia, today, you died in your home of unknown causes." So I literally go, "This is true, as true as I'm standing here." Sort of, so I go to Wikipedia, and I look my name up, and I go, and sure enough, it says April 4th, 1972, January 22nd, 2019. I go down, read, scroll on down, accurate information, every bit of it, go to death, click on death. There it is. Patrick Nix was found dead in his Pinson Valley, or his Pinson home, this morning of unknown causes. Yeah. So you talk about a reality check to life. It's quickly, I quickly text my wife to say, "Hey, look, I'm good. Everything's fine. No problems." Later on, Caleb, my son, is here, and, he came in, and we laughed about it a little bit. He actually pulled it up, and I've got a screenshot of it because my brother-in-law screenshotted it and had to tweet out that I'm still alive. And later, Bo texted me later in the day and said, "Dad, are you dead?" And, I said, "No, just call me Lazarus, buddy. I'm back." Wikipedia tried to kill me off, but they couldn't. So I figured I'm on borrowed time now. I'm living in the bonus days now. I've died, here we are, and so I figured I don't have anything to lose. But it was a little bit of an interesting time, especially when you read your name. I'm not being serious here for a second, man. When you read your name and that dash is completed, it'll wake you up a little bit. Because there is no doubt I'm not above being found dead in my Pinson home tomorrow morning. If that's what God chooses, there's no doubt. So I better get busy living if I'm going to live. And I'm thankful that I'm still here today, and I'm thankful I'm still living, and thankful everything's good. But can you pull that picture up real quick? I've got to start here. I've got to show my family, and we've been very blessed. Most of you know the last 2 years, we're 28-1. We lost the Hoover first game this past year, but we've had two state championships at Pinson, and very, very blessed. God is really good, amazingly good. But you see Bo there beside me, my wife Krista, who I would like for you to please pray for her. My father-in-law, her stepdad, having surgery in the morning to find out got a little cancer issue going on, and we're hoping that, it's nothing major, having a little biopsy on his liver, so we're hoping everything's good. So she's in Nashville tonight, drove up this afternoon. My daughter Sarah with the prophy, the head of the house, that's 11 years old. When most of you that understand when you got kids, you understand that. Then my daughter Emma Grace, who we're praying through nursing school right now, and we used to think that when they were young, if we just ever get them to grow up, I wish they'd go right back to being young again, because the problems just get bigger. So we're praying her through nursing school right now at Auburn. And then the next one out there is Tez, who's a new member of our family for about 9 months. Tez came to live with us back in April, and he gets Krista's size, and you see how skinny he is. He gets my athletic ability because he can run real well. So I take credit for the athletic ability and the way he catches it. Tez actually this year was set a record third in the state in history in the state of Alabama with 107 catches this year. And so proud. It's all a story within itself that we could talk one day. And then the last one but not least is Caleb, my ninth grade son, that is sort of the one that keeps everything rolling and keeps everything going. And that right there is why I do what I do. And it's a mix. It used to be the mix six. We were the mix six for a long time, but now we get to be the mix seven. And hopefully before too long we can be the mix eight, mix nine, and we just keep adding to our numbers as we go. But very thankful for that family right there. Very thankful God has blessed me with them. But God has blessed me. I got a dad that's absolutely incredible, the most godly man I've ever been around in my life. To this day, he'll still call me. And in his way, he used to try to be, he was never subtle about it. Every Sunday, after lunch, he's called and asked me, "Did you go to church this morning? How was it?" Every Sunday, to this day, it doesn't matter when I was in college, it didn't matter. He called to ask, every Sunday, and just an absolute godly man, and wouldn't be here without him. I'm just so thankful for he and my mom, and life is just it's tough. My dad's best friend passed away a night or two ago of cancer. And I got the text from Dad. I guess it was Friday night or Saturday morning, because it was yesterday, Saturday morning. So they're dealing with that. And, their father-in-law that's dealing. So, I'm getting to that age. I got reading glasses here that I got to wear now. And, parents that you're dealing with, and life comes at you now. And it's not going to stop. It comes very fast. I'm very thankful for my parents and how wonderful they are. And was very, very fortunate, to be able to go to Auburn and play and have some good years of playing, and then left and went straight to Jacksonville State, where Coach Burgess was my first head coach. And talking about learning some football. Thank goodness I had Coach Burgess, because it was real football. It wasn't the underwear stuff that you can get some today, but it was real football. I got to go with Coach Burgess and spend a year with him, and was at Jacksonville State, then was the youngest and dumbest head coach in America out at Henderson State. I was 25 years old and went out to Arkansas Division III school and became a head coach out there. Made a lot of mistakes, but learned from it, grew from it. Came back to Stanford, was here for a year when I first time here at Shades back in 2000, I think it was. So was here for a year. Then went to Georgia Tech for a few years, and to Miami after Georgia Tech. And the whole time, I was a good dad. I was a good husband. Really worked hard at it. But there was no doubt what I was pursuing and what I was chasing and what I was trying to do. There was no doubt. I wanted to be the head coach at Auburn. I wanted to be the head coach in Division I. I wanted to be offensive coordinator. Wanted all that stuff. The money, I didn't really care about any of that kind of stuff. I enjoyed calling plays, enjoyed running an offense, enjoyed being a leader, enjoyed being around coaches, enjoyed being around kids, and saw that as my way of God giving me an opportunity to impact, the nation because of that. And truthfully, I felt like if God gave me the opportunity to be at Auburn, I could have an opportunity to impact the state, therefore impact the nation, therefore impact the country and the world for Jesus Christ by Him giving me that job. He has very easily and quickly shown me that I have so much more of an impact right where I am. I've impacted where I'm at and impacted the world from where I'm at right there in high school coaching. That God doesn't have to have this great, wonderful title and all this kind of stuff. God just wants us. I just go into Ian Bound, a great author and a prayer. If you really want to get deep, Some of you think you're deep. Some of you, if you want to go deep, some of you may have read inbounds. If you haven't, go ahead. Step right off and you'll go as deep as you want to go. And he is absolutely incredible. One of my favorite lines of any book ever besides the Bible. Ian Bounds wrote, that man is looking for better methods. We're always looking for better methods. We're always looking for better ways to worship him and serve him and get involved and do this and do that. Or, you know, be a better dad, be a better husband. Always looking for these better methods. Ian Bounds said, man is looking for better methods. God's looking for better men. God doesn't need titles. He didn't need me to be the head coach at Auburn. He didn't need all that kind of stuff. He just needed a man willing to do what he's calling me to do. Not what I wanted to do, but what he wanted me to do. So I challenge us as men, and we'll talk about that for a while tonight, to quit looking for methods and just be a man. Just be the man that God's called us to be. A Bible-fearing, a Bible-reading man. But, you know, it never fails wherever I go. If we'd had wives in here earlier, we'd had the wives and moms and all that, there's no doubt we'd have had a little bit more pep in our step when we were singing those songs. We laugh, we think it's funny and all that, but it's a shame that men can't get passionate about Christ. It really infuriates me. It drives me crazy. It drives me crazy that my generation and above, including my dad and everybody else, we want to talk about the kids that are coming up. They don't respect anybody. They don't do anything. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, we sit on our hands during church, and we won't do anything. We don't even respect God enough to worship him during church. So how are we expecting people below us to see you? They don't have any respect for anybody. And so it just infuriates me in Sunday school when we sit there, and when they say, hey, somebody read Ephesians 3:20. Man, just sort of sit there and stare at death. Come on, not read good. First thing, well, one of my wives are there and she's reading it just like that. We just sit there and let it happen. I don't know what's happened to men. I really don't. I don't know what's happened to us. I don't know where we lost our way. Maybe it was like this back in the 1920s. I don't know. I didn't live there. I know how it is now in the 2020s. And men need to step up and start being men. Including myself. I'm not throwing stones. I'm not saying anything. I'm talking about myself, too. We need to step up and be men. When I got with Miami, was offensive coordinator at Miami, it was when Coach Coverville got let go. Auburn called, and I was one of the top five. I got the interview for the head job at Auburn. Middle of December, I go and interview for the head job at Auburn. We go play in a bowl game at the end of December. By January 1st, I was fired from the University of Miami. Within a two-week span, I interviewed for my dream job and got fired from the job that I was at. My head was spinning. Didn't know exactly what God was trying to show me, what he was teaching me, what I needed to do. Didn't know. So I just began to do what any God-fearing person maybe would do. What I got into God's Word and just started going. Jeremiah, by the way, if you ever get that, Jeremiah is the greatest mentor that God may have ever created in the book of Jeremiah. Great. Pick it up and start reading it. It's amazing. God just discipled me, himself, me and Jeremiah. I think he and I had a great Bible study for about 3 months. But during that time, I drove my daughter, Emma Grace, who was probably in the 6th, 7th grade at that time. We drove to Atlanta. We drove over, and I was going to visit with the Falcons that day, and she was going to go visit some friends that we had at Georgia Tech. And on the drive, this little drive, I think we'd just come to Birmingham at that time, driving over to Atlanta. On the way, we started talking about her teachers. And as we drove, she started talking about this teacher and that teacher. You know how girls are. They know everything about every one of their teachers and all this stuff. She was just loving telling the stories, and as she was telling, I just sat there. Next thing I know, I'm just bawling my eyes out. And I didn't know a single one of them. I didn't know a single one of her teachers. Didn't know what they looked like. Didn't know anything about them. And I was a good dad. I'm not even going to sit here and pretend. And most of you have known me for a long time, and you knew I was a good dad. I'll tell you, I was a good dad. I worked hard at it. I tried to be a good dad. But I realized that my investment was in the wrong spot. And at that moment, on that drive, and I'd also been reading the story of David and Goliath that we're going to go, and I've actually written a book that's over here, David Had a Dad, that God started working on me through the story of David and Goliath and through Jesse that I needed to start investing in my children better. I needed to invest in my children better, more. They needed to be my disciples. And it's pretty neat now. Every morning I get up and I start texting. You know, I'll read my, wherever I'm at in the Bible or whatever I'm doing right now. I'm going through Proverbs, every, you know, every day, and I've decided that's where I'm going to be with my kids. And so every morning when I get up, almost every morning, I can't say every morning, but almost every morning when I get up, I'm going to read somewhere in the Bible, and there's going to be a text go out to all four of mine, my new one, my hopefully soon-to-be son-in-law, and a couple others. But every morning, there's going to be a text that's going to go out to them with Scripture. Because I know they're going to have Scripture every day. If they're not, if they choose not to read, that's up to them. They're going to have to read my text every day. They don't have to. So I've intentionally chosen. There's a lot of other things that I've, God has laid on my heart to intentionally do with my kids to invest in their lives. And it's the, I left after that. I left Miami and decided to, took a year off, decided not to go back, did not want to go back to the rat race of Division One. Thought I could go down to Division One AA when Charleston Southern, tried that. And it was just as much time and ended up going to high school for the sole purpose of being around my kids and investing. It was absolute the greatest investment I've ever made in my life. To see my daughter every single day. To know her teachers. To let her come to me and talk to me. To be able to text her and call her every day still, knowing that she knows that she can trust me. And more than anything, she knows that I put everything aside to be with her. There's nothing greater. And that's another story for another day of why I went to Charleston Southern, because God told her, Dad, you need to be in coaching. Middle of the night, 2 a.m. in the morning in Black Mountain, North Carolina, she walks in and tells Kristen and I that God just told her that I need to be in coaching. I promise you this, I wasn't getting out after that. No matter what, I was going somewhere to coach. Because I was going to make sure she understood that God can talk to you. What He does, we listen. But it's been a ride. It's been crazy. It's been, you know, there's ups and downs constantly to it. But it has been the greatest investment I've ever made. But during that time, rewinding a little bit, going back to those Miami days, when I got fired, I'd always studied David, loved David. Anytime, anywhere, and when it says in Acts that David was a man after God's own heart, I decided early in my life, I want to be like that dude. If they say he's like God, I want to be like that dude. I didn't realize he had all those bad things that he had done at that time in my life. I didn't know all that stuff. I was like, man, I want to be like that dude. He must have been great. So I start studying, but, you know, and then I learn he did some good things and some bad things that we can all learn from. But we all go to one place when we go to David, right? I mean, we just, you go to David and Goliath. You can't help but go to David and Goliath. So I had studied David and Goliath. I spoke on David and Goliath for years and had done Bible studies on it and done things for our teams that I coached and all this kind of stuff. And God laid on my heart after that to start studying again and start writing some notes down. Next thing I know, as I was looking at it, I really started studying. And if we'll pull up 1 Samuel 17, is where I'm at. If you got your Bible, if you want to look, we're going to be in 1 Samuel 17 for a lot of this. As I started reading, you know, 1 Samuel 17, we start, to me, it's sort of what I call the tale of the tape between Goliath and David. 1 Samuel 17, 4 through 7, it starts telling us a little bit about Goliath. And there it is. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'm going to paraphrase. You can read it as I go, but talking about Goliath and how he's a champion warrior and how he's got this and he's got that. And he's got his armor's this big and this heavy and he's got this big of a spear and this big of a sword and he's this strong and he's this and he's that. It tells you all this stuff that he has. And it makes me think about travel baseball. We got to have that best bat, don't we? And we'll spend whatever it takes for my son to have the biggest and baddest bat. I'm getting into softball now. My 11-year-old said, hopefully she's going to start. She's going to be really good. She's the best athlete in the family. So I'm like, yeah, let's go, girl. You can get after this. Let's go. So, you know, you're going to get the best stuff you can get, right? But that's what we do as dads. My kids don't go walk out with the best. So Goliath had it all. He had all the stuff. The best money could buy, the best you could have. Then you look at David. I think it's very interesting. You look at verses 12 through 14 on David. It said, now David was the son of an Ephrathite named Jesse, who was from Bethlehem in Judah. Jesse had eight sons, and in Saul's time, he was very old. Jesse's three oldest sons had followed Saul to the war, firstborn, secondborn, thirdborn. David was the youngest. The three oldest followed Saul. And it hit me. You know, Goliath had all this stuff. Goliath had everything that you could get. Had all this stuff. But David had a dad. There was something about Jesse. That all these years I studied David and Goliath, and I'd missed it. There's something about Jesse. There's something about him. God wouldn't put him in there like this if there wasn't something about him. And then when you keep on going, 1 Samuel 17:55, towards the end. This is after David goes down and he defeats the Goliath, and we know all that kind of stuff. And most of it stopped going. Most of it stopped at the end. Maybe before or after when David chops the head off and holds it up. And just that's a whole other stuff. But just think how long. That head had to be massive, man. Goliath's head. And he's sitting there running around with it. All this kind of, I just can't imagine that. But he ran around for a long time holding that trophy. But I love it. It says, as Saul watched David going out to meet the Philistine, he said to Abner, commander of the army, Abner, whose son is this young man? Not who trained him for battle, not where did he learn, whose son is that young man? And I started realizing that there's a lot more to Jesse than we realize. He goes on, he said, as surely as you live, your majesty, the king said, find out whose son is this young man. As soon as they returned, the king killed the Philistine. However, he says, whose son are you? David said, I'm the son of your servant, Jesse of Bethlehem. There's something about Jesse. There's something about a dad. There's something about it. And then we're kind of, we've missed it in a lot of ways, I think, at dads. We've missed it. Some of you are on the front end of this thing. You got those little ones. It's set up. Don't miss it. Some of us right now, we're right in the middle of it, man. I've got an 11-year-old to a 21-year-old. We're right dead in the middle of it. Some of you are sitting there and you've got grown kids. You're grown. It's not too late. Absolutely not too late. But we can't miss it. We can't miss the fact that there's something about a dad. David had a dad. Man is looking for better methods. God's looking for better methods. You know, I applaud what Bill and them are doing with the kids, the young boys and their dad. I applaud it. It's unbelievably great. But wouldn't it be great if they had a dad? That's how God intended. I understand things happen. Totally get it. Totally get it. My mom died when she was 7. Dad was an alcoholic. She was having to live with my aunt, her sister, by the time she was 10. Didn't have her dad. I get it. I know there's situations out there. But to vote for those of us that can be dad, we need to be dad. We don't need a better method. God's already given that. God's given us the method. It's right here in God's Word. If you're not sure, just pick up and read Deuteronomy 6. Just go right ahead. Read it. There's your blueprint right there of how to be a dad. You'll be in good shape. If you live that out every day, you'll be just fine. You don't need a better method. We just need to live out what God calls to be. What God calls to be. You know, I think one of the great lessons when we start getting into the story of David and Goliath, and most of us know the story, just unbelievable things like, you know, David, he didn't get to go off the war with his brothers. Although he'd already been anointed king, he has to stay away, doesn't get to go and be part of the war. Amazing to me how that happens, but it's the way God intended it, it's the way it worked. So for 40 days and 40 nights, Goliath comes down. He challenges them. We know the story. They stand up there, you know, nobody does anything. We know David finally, his dad tells him to get up and go. And sure enough, he gets up and goes. And when does he go? Early in the morning, like he's supposed to. Gets there. Because just think, if David doesn't go early in the morning to get there, does he ever even see David come, or Goliath come out? Probably not. But because David did what he was supposed to do when he was supposed to do it, he was there to meet God's calling. We need to know that as men, too. Our boys need to know that. Our daughters need to know that. When you do what God asks you to do, when He asks you to do it, you're going to meet God's calling. you don't mean it. So David gets there, and sure enough, and you can imagine, they go out, and it's like Tiger Walk, man. I mean, they're all going crazy. The war paint's on, they're chanting, ready to fight, and all this kind of stuff. Then all of a sudden, Goliath comes out, and they go, back up. David's like, what's going on? Who is this dude? Well, they start hearing some reports to Saul of what's going on. So Saul calls David to him. Well, David goes to him, and it's in 1 Samuel 17, verse 32. Saul calls David to him, and David says, hey, don't lose heart on account of this Philistine. Don't lose hope on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight. You know, I feel like we live in a world today where a lot of us we've lost hope. We see what's going on with the government. The government shuts down. They can't get anything right. Trump needs to stop tweeting and just shut his mouth, do his job. And I don't know, Nancy Pelosi would do this. And I mean, we think the world's coming to an end with politics. We think the world's coming to an end. Oh, heaven, I won't go there. I'm going to start to go with football, but I won't go there. Because heaven forbid one of our teams lose, right? The whole world's got to shut down. I don't know how you can preach on a Sunday after teams lose. Because when you walk in, nobody wants to hear any good news and joy. No, I hate life if my team lost. And I trust me, I know my son's about to be there getting booed every time he throws an interception. And I wish I never wanted to fight. And then I'm going to walk into church the next Sunday and act like I'm, oh, yeah. And I'm going to fight Saturday night with somebody. So trust me, I get it. Hey, I'm with you. We've lost hope, though. A lot of times I think we've just totally lost hope. And David just said simply, don't lose hope on account of that Philistine. Don't lose hope on account that your son threw an interception. Don't lose hope on account that your team lost. Don't lose hope that on account that your business is going under. Don't lose hope to the fact that you've gone bankrupt. Don't lose hope on any of that. You see, David realized hope hadn't left. Hope was there the whole time. The guys just couldn't see it. You see, hope was in God, the Lord, his God. For us, we don't have to hope in that. We hope in the true life of Jesus Christ and the fact that he came and lived and died for us. That's our hope. So we don't have to worry about all this hope in a business, hope in a son, hope in a daughter, hope in a job, hope in a government, hope in a pastor, hope in a small group. We don't have to have hope in any of that kind of stuff, because if we have hope in Jesus Christ, none of it matters. He'll handle every bit of it for us. The problem is we've lost our hope. We've lost our hope. We're just like those guys standing up on the mountain and we on the hill and we've got a battle. And trust me, I had the greatest experience of my life 2 years ago. I got to go to Israel. We're over there in Israel. And we're with a group, and this one guy that lives there with the group, he lives there permanently. He's lived there for about 13, 14 years. Somehow, we just got a great conversation started up. He's from Georgia. He played high school football in the state for Georgia. I knew who his coach was. He had heard of my dad. We get to talking. Next thing I know, that sucker's got Chris and I in the car driving out to the valley of where they fought. And I'm like, man, it don't get any better. So we pull off the road. We're pulling off. And they don't let you go to these places now. Because this is where you get killed. This is not the safe places to go to. So we're driving out through there. He pulls off on a dirt road. I'm like, Christian, we're going to die. We pull off a dirt road. We go down in the middle of this valley. We get out, and he says, it would have been somewhere right around in here. I'm like, oh, my gosh, you're kidding me. He says, let's keep exploring. So he takes his car, kid you not. We go on. You got the valley over here with the Philistines, and he gets the biblicals. I mean, you're sitting there, I'm reading, I'm like, oh, my, you're kidding me. It's there. So we see where the Philistines would have been, over on that other side of the valley. We're driving about to go up this hill. And as we start to go up the hill, guess what we came to? Yeah, a little stream bed, right? He had to get his five smooth stones out of the stream bed. Right there it was. I got four of them at my house. I left one of them because I know Goliath still got it in his forehead. So I left. I only got four. I only came back with four. But I got four in my house right now, in my top drawer, four stones out of that stream bed. We drive on up that hill. I kid you not. We drive up that hill. And they've come and they've started excavating about 5 years ago. And somewhere, I'd have to find in an Old Testament, because one of the other guys, I had to go back and start talking to him, one of the guys that lived in Israel, that's a Bible scholar, and knew everything. Somewhere in the Bible, it talks about it. That David, after that, he went back and built a fortified city on top of the hill where they had camped. So we get out, and there it is. There's the fortified city that they had built right there where the Israelites had camped there. And so you're sitting there thinking, I wonder if he came up this side of the mountain where he, oh my gosh. And it makes you realize hope has not been lost. The same God he served then is the same God I serve today. The same God that parted the Red Sea, that you know Jesse sat around the campfires with his older sons and the brothers, and they talked about all the miracles of God. The same God that did those is the same God that can do miracles today and still does miracles today. And to stand right there and look and know that I serve the same God there that took care of Goliath then is the same God that will take care of my Goliath today. Hope has not been lost. It's not been lost. For whatever reason, we just choose not to see it sometimes. On those black and dreary days that things aren't so good, oh man, hope has not been lost. And it never will be, because God will never cease to exist, and Jesus Christ will never cease to exist, and His Word will never exist. We will always, for eternity, forever and ever and ever, there will be hope. No matter what the situation. But not only do you say, hey, don't lose hope on account of that Philistine, there's another little part that has to happen. We can stand here and talk about this hope all night. And David said this little phrase after that I love. Don't lose hope on account of that Philistine. I'll go fight. Too many of us today, we're out of the fighting business. We stop fighting. We get tired. And trust me, I know. I've got one from 21 to 11. And it gets tough. They tell me all the time, y'all, that Sarah, do whatever she wants to. Yeah, you're probably right. I used to beat your tail all the time, and now she just do whatever she wants to. Bo says it all the time. You used to beat me for that. Yeah, I did. You needed it. Most of you remember Bo when he was like this. He needed it. You know, he got kicked out of every preschool we went to, and so he needed it. Needed every beating he got, you know. And it paid off now, I think. You know, he's doing pretty good, doing what he's supposed to. You know, went to church this morning. And so, you know, I'm doing my dad now. I checked the box. He went to church. I'm doing something right. I just keep going to church, you know. And I pray now somebody will be there to disciple him. I'm just praying for a disciple. God, just please send him somebody to disciple him. Thank goodness I found one when I was there. It came on. But we got to fight. We can't. We got to know where our hope is. We got to fight. As a coach, as a leader, you know what one of my favorite books of the Bible is. All I can do is Nehemiah. I mean, if you haven't read Nehemiah, if you think you're a leader, read Nehemiah. That's a leader. Anybody can go back in and rebuild a wall and do the things and get a group of people that have no hope to do what they do. Amazing. But I love Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 14 and 15. See, what's happened is Nehemiah's went back to the Jerusalem and they're rebuilding the wall. The wall had been torn down. It had been torn down for years. No hope of rebuilding this wall now. There's no logic to these people of how we're going to rebuild this wall because it's been down for all this time. Well, how are we going to rebuild it now? Well, somehow Nehemiah convinces them, we're going to rebuild this wall. And they start rebuilding the wall. And Nehemiah chapter 4 falls right about halfway. And what always happens halfway of anything? Everybody wants to quit. I promise you, like Rich said, like they said, the Bible study is going to be overflowing for the next couple weeks. But about 3 weeks from now, attendance will go down. Why? Because we don't have it in us anymore to keep fighting. We get halfway, and oh gosh, these leaders, Sanballat said something bad. He said that we're not building it stronger. They're going to come attack me, and they're going to kill me. I'm scared. Satan's been attacking forever, y'all. He's attacking Nehemiah, he's attacking in 1 Samuel, he's attacking now. Satan ain't going to stop attacking. He's going to battle you like crazy. You sign up for one of these Bible studies, and I promise you, you're going to get the busiest calendar, busiest month you've ever had. It just depends on whether you're willing to fight through it or not. It's simple. It's not hard. You know, we get into halftime of a game, and we've had some games where we're down at halftime. It's a very simple process. Are you going to battle and fight? Or are you just going to walk out there and let them win? Nobody said you were going to walk out and win every game. Nobody said that you were just going to walk through life and everything going to be easy. It's a fight sometimes. It looks like, you can say that. You got two state championship trophies. You come watch us any day from 12 o'clock to 1:30, and you tell me if it's not a fight. You'll see us fighting those guys tooth and nail with everything we got, yelling at them to get lower, to get up, to do this, to do that. It's a fight. It's a fight all year to get to where we want to get to. Nothing in life worth having is easy. And a relationship, a true relationship, being holy, there's nothing greater. So if there's nothing greater than that, you better expect it's going to be a fight. You think God's just going to pour holiness in you and say, here, open up, there's righteousness, you don't have to worry about anything else ever again. Well, that'd be nice, wouldn't it? Don't quite work like that. It's work. And you might have to sacrifice and wake up at 5:30 in the morning and read your Bible. You might have to sacrifice and get out of work a little bit to go watch your son play. You might have to sacrifice, and I'm the world's worst at this, so Caleb, you and Taz don't say a word. You might have to sacrifice and actually go buy your wife a thing of flowers or a card. You might have to fight for that relationship. Yes, she might get tired of you. You might have to fight for it a little bit. I love Nehemiah 4:14. That's what's going on right now in Nehemiah 4:14. They're ready to quit. They're scared, not sure. And it tells us, after Nehemiah looked things over, he stood up and said to the people, he gathered all the people together. Okay, all the people, because you hear it says, the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. That would be us, right? That'd be me. I wasn't a noble, wouldn't have been official. I'd just been the rest of the people. Okay? So you out there that think, well, he can't be talking to me because I don't really do anything. I don't have anybody. I'm not a father. I'm not a grandfather. I'm not anything. Well, you're the rest of the people. Okay? Understand that now. I don't care who you are in here. You're on this list. We understand. Is everybody clear with that? Don't give me this excuse that, well, I don't have this, I don't have that. You're the rest of the people then. Okay? So everybody in here is in the fight. Everybody. Don't care what your situation is. Don't care what your excuse is. Everybody in here is in the fight. He says, don't be afraid of them. Love this point. Remember the Lord. I think too many times we forget who we serve. Too many times we forget what Jesus did for us. On that same trip to the Holy Land, I was able to stand where they believe 99.9% sure that Jesus would have been taken as beatings, being whipped, being spit on, being mocked. And why did he do it? Not for you. He did it for me. For me. He did it for that picture you saw just a minute ago. He did it for that group of people, that seven people right there. In my mind, that's who he did it for. He fought for me. We forget that sometimes. Remember the Lord. Remember what he's done for you. And if he hasn't, if you know, he ain't done anything for me, I tell you, hell is real hot. He hasn't done anything for you, you go and experience for the rest of eternity and you see what he's done for you. He's done nothing else for you but save you from your sins and save you from hell and give you the opportunity to go to heaven because you've asked him in your life to be your salvation and to be your sin penalty, your death penalty, for his blood to cover over all of it so you don't have to go to hell. Don't tell me he's never done anything for me. You don't need anything else other than that. None of us do. I sure don't. Every morning I wake up, every night when I go to bed, and all throughout the day, they'll tell you, they'll catch me crying at times, I just think, God, I don't deserve any of this. I'm so thankful you died for me. And not only me. Thankful, you guys. Because you know, as a dad, we try to do everything for our kids, don't we? But guess what? You can't get them to heaven. You know, no matter how hard you try, no matter how much money you make, no matter how much you baby them, how much you give them, whatever, how many times you take them to church, you can't get them to heaven. That's only through Jesus Christ and what He did for them. So don't think anything. Remember the Lord. When it is rough, when your walls are falling down around you, remember the Lord, who is great and awesome. Remember the Lord, who is great and awesome. Now, this is the fun part. Remember the Lord, who is great and awesome, and fight. Fight for your families, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your homes. Now, Pastor Danny's in here, so I got to be careful. I realize it. I'm going to step off into some theology stuff here that I really don't need to be stepping off in. Prayer arguably is probably, it's number one. Can't get much higher than prayer, right? Reading your Bible, can't get much higher than that. But, I don't know if you can get much higher than fighting. I really don't. Because that's what praying is. That's what reading your Bible is. That's what going to a small group is. It's fighting. It's fighting to be holy. It's fighting to knowing more. Not just singing the song, but fighting. Fighting for your family. And when they're talking about family there, they're talking about us. Us fighting for each other. That's what it's talking about. For us now, we know who the church is. The church belongs to Jesus Christ and the followers of Jesus Christ. That's who we're fighting with and for. Not only each other, but our sons, our daughters, our wives. And I challenge you, have you really fought for them lately? What have you done to fight for them lately? Not just what have you done to do something for them. Now, let's understand what a fight is, right? A fight's not standing up on that mountain saying, I can take Goliath. No, a fight is thinking, walking down to there, grabbing some stones, and going out there and fighting him. And risking getting killed. That's what fighting is. We're scared to death to fight now. We're scared to death. You don't understand, Coach. I work in a public school. I'd be fired for that. Yeah, you're right. 100%. I work in Jefferson County school system. We share the gospel at least one day a week. At least this past week, our word was faith. And we had a lot of fun sharing faith this week. Last year, after the Carver game, we had a young man die in a house fire, an eighth grader. And I'll go ahead and go down that road because I think you need to hear. That still breaks my heart today. I shared the gospel with our varsity guys, but I failed to go down and share the gospel with our seventh and eighth graders. Had an eighth grader die. His soul is on me. I don't know where he's at. I didn't fight that fight. Are you really fighting the fight? I could get fired tomorrow. No doubt. They got plenty to fire me. Are you living a life to get fired? Fire me. I've been fired before from a much better job. It's okay. You're not paying me that much anyway. All of you know what I make. It was at AL.com. If you don't know, you go and look at it. It's all on there. Everybody knows what I make. And it's below halfway of everybody else, but I ain't doing this for no money. I tell people all the time, if I wanted the money, I'd be calling one of my buddies that are up there in the NFL college begging, hey, give me a seat at the table so I can get back up there. No, I love the fight I'm in. Love it. Love it. I love the movie Cinderella Man. Some of you have seen it, some of you have. James J. Braddock, boxer back in the 20s. 30s. Average boxer through the 20s, won a little bit, but more than anything, he lost. Really got on a losing streak there for a while. And that losing streak, towards the end of it, the Great Depression hits. When the Great Depression hits, there's nothing. No jobs, no anything. He's got a bum hand. He was broken during, you know, fighting and everything that he couldn't really work with. So he couldn't get much of a job. So the story shows he's got three kids, a wife. They're living in a very, very bad place, just trying to survive. Next thing you know, their power's cut off. Next thing you know, and it's cold. Wife goes out to get the milk one day. When she goes out, it says, past due. There is no milk. When you know the movie, she's in there finding a piece of bologna. He doesn't eat it. He gives it to the kids, gives his share to the kids. There is no more food. There is no more anything. There is no more anything. And he loses his wife and his kids. He's fortunate enough to get another fight. Somebody gets hurt, falls off the card, and the guy that was managing that, he says, hey, will you come fight? Yeah, I'll fight. Goes and fights, wins. Fights the next fight, wins. True story, a guy by the name of Max Baer was the champion at the time, heavyweight champion. Literally had killed somebody in the ring a couple fights before. Hit him so hard, killed him. They asked Braddock, you want to fight him? Yeah, I'll fight him. Can I make money? I'll fight him. So all of a sudden, here's James Braddock about to fight Max Baer, who's just everything. They have this press conference. During a press conference, one of the reporters that had covered, you know, Braddock for a while, we have any reporters in here, I ought to be careful with what I say about reporters. But he was your typical reporter trying to get, you know, stir Braddock up a little bit, trying to take some jabs at him a little bit, all this kind of stuff. Said, hey, Jimmy, you weren't any good. You were getting killed, you were getting knocked out, couldn't win a fight. Now all of a sudden you've gotten better. What's changed? Braddock looks around for a minute. And looks up and says, I know what I'm fighting for now. Oh, yeah, what's that? Milk. See, sooner or later, put that picture back up. Sooner or later, you got to figure out what you're fighting for. And you got to figure out what it's worth. That right there is worth my life. Discipling them. Not just providing for them, put food on the table, discipling them. Having that crew right there changed the world. That little crew right there changed the world through Jesus Christ. It's worth fighting for every day. Every day it's worth the fight. Now, I've got two of my boys sitting right here, and I think they'll attest to everything. If you want to pull them aside, they'll attest to it. And every day it's a fight. Ted joined us just over 8 months ago, and sometimes you wonder, Coach, you're crazy. You're absolutely crazy. Why can't I just go out with these people? Because we're different. It's hard to say no as a dad. My kids don't think it's very hard for me to say no, and it's not. It's not at all. Hate me all you want. The fight is absolutely worth it. So I challenge you, do you know what you're fighting for? More importantly, let's take a step back. Are you even in the fight? Some of you in here, it's not that you've lost hope. You've never had hope. If you don't have a relationship, a personal relationship, not a church relationship, not sitting in a pew, not being a member of a church, but a personal relationship, that relationship of one time, at some point in your life, you've asked Jesus Christ to be the penalty for your sins. If you don't have that relationship, you're right, you have no hope. Everything I've said tonight for you, you have no hope. I'm sorry. I wish I could help you. I can't help you. I can't help you. Jesus can. I tell you about it. But without Jesus Christ, you're right. You have no hope. But see, David knew who his God was. Therefore, he had hope. 2 Corinthians 3:12. Last verse I'll share with you here. It says, therefore, since we have such a hope, what is that hope? That hope is that Jesus Christ came, lived for 33 years, died a horrifying death after living a sinless life, was dead for 3 days, rose from the grave, and is alive today, so I can have hope that I'm going to be in eternity in heaven with Him. That is such a hope. And that's the hope I have. And the hope I have is that the same Spirit that rose Jesus Christ from the dead is the same one that will protect me and keep me from getting fired, or if I do get fired, give me another job, whatever. As long as I'm living for Christ and proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ, I am protected to the fullest. There is no way I can't be. When I have that kind of hope, we are very bold. And notice it doesn't say you can be if you choose to be. No, it says we are very bold. So in the next household, for the next seven, they don't have a lot of choice. They're just not. Live a bold life. Don't live this ho-hum life. Don't live this life that everybody else just sort of, you can throw a ball good. I don't care how good you can throw a ball, son. Love Jesus. Love Him with all of your heart and with everything in you. You love others, and everything will work out just fine. He promises us that. When we have such a hope, we are to be very bold. If you don't have that hope, you can't be bold. I'm going to ask us to close our eyes for a minute. I want to do something very simple. If you got your eyes closed, I just ask you, if you will, for me, just really be still for a minute. Most important time of the night, right here. I want you to think, with your eyes closed, head bowed, I want you to think of that moment. And there's only one moment, y'all. That moment when you asked Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. My moment was at Green Acres Baptist Church. I was 7 years old in Green Acres Baptist Church in Warner Robins, Georgia. There was a puppet show going on. Why a puppet show? I have no idea. But I know during that puppet show, I felt God tugging on my heart that I needed to find out about Jesus Christ. And I went to my Sunday school teacher. And I asked my Sunday school teacher, we prayed for me to receive Jesus Christ right there that day, right in that little room at Green Acres Baptist Church. And I know that I know that I know without a doubt in my mind that that was the moment that Jesus Christ came into my life and became my Savior. He saved me from hell, and now I'm going to have eternity in heaven. If you don't have, first, if you can remember that moment, if you have that moment, I want you right there silently just to praise God for that moment, because that is the absolute greatest moment that you've ever had in your life, and we don't praise Him for that moment enough. We don't remember that time and that God enough that saved us. But if you don't have that moment, I don't care how many years you've been in church. I don't care how many Bible verse stories you've heard. I don't care. If you don't have that moment, if you don't have the moment when you've asked Jesus Christ into your heart to be your personal Lord and Savior, I'm going to challenge that maybe you don't have a relationship with Him. Maybe you think you do, but you really don't. Because the Bible is very clear, there's only one way to heaven. And it's not how many times I check the box of going to church. It's not how much money I give to church. It's not how great my pastor is. It's not how great my family is. It's none of that. There's only one way, and that's through Jesus Christ. His death, burial, and resurrection for your sin. And you accepting that. That's the only way. Because God knows no sin. And the only way that we can get rid of our sin is by accepting Him to be our death penalty. So if you don't have that moment, in just a minute, I'm going to challenge you. We'll have men standing up here on the side. I'm going to challenge you to walk to one of those men and say, I've never had one of those moments. I need hope. Some of you in here tonight, you've lost hope. Maybe you and your wife were separated, divorced. You might have a kid that's gone astray and you just don't see any hope. Business is tough. I don't know. There's so many different things that can be going on. And you just feel like you've lost hope. I challenge you tonight to come down forward. Get on your knees right here in front of God. And remember Him. remember the fact that you still have hope. And get in the fight. Some of you have been fighting and maybe you're a little tired. Maybe you're like Nehemiah 4 and you're tired. You're tired of the fight. You just need to be recharged tonight. You just need to come down front and just pray and say, God, I need to be recharged. And there's a bunch of us out here tonight that we're not even in the fight. We know Jesus. We've got a relationship. But we're just trying to keep fighting. Get in the fight. Fight for your families. Fight for your sons. Fight for your daughters. Fight for your wives. Fight. God has called us to fight as men. He doesn't need new methods. He doesn't need new services. He doesn't need this and that. He needs men that are willing to fight. That are willing to go off the mountain, go off the hill, go down in the valley, and face whatever Goliath you're facing, and fight. That's what he needs. We got enough men standing up on the hill watching. We need some men down in the valley. So before you leave tonight, whether you like it or not, you're making a choice. You're either choosing to follow Jesus Christ or not choosing to follow Jesus Christ. And if you do follow Jesus Christ, you're either choosing to get in the fight or I'm not getting in the fight. And don't walk out and say, well, think about it. If you think about it, that means you're not. That means you're not in the fight. But at least tonight when you leave, you'll know where you stand. You'll know whether you're in the fight or you're not in the fight. You'll either know whether you know Jesus Christ or you don't know Jesus Christ. Hopefully there's no confusion when you walk out of here tonight. You know where you stand. My prayer is that everyone else will be in the fight. Dear Lord, we just praise you. We thank you. And now I pray for boldness in this room. I know a lot of the men in this room, and I'm one of them, but sometimes it's real hard. Get out of that seat and go down and take a knee in front of God because it shows I might have a weakness. Can't do that. I'm a man. No, a real man falls on his face before God. Dear Lord, I just pray tonight that some men will just break down their own hearts. Be vulnerable and know that you are God. And we serve an awesome and mighty God. And we'll be willing to remember our hope. Know that we have hope.